awake, you will die. You will die. So I asked the traditional question, what is sin? What is sin? And we, those of us that have been in church for a while, we know the typical answers. That doesn't mean that they change. So we're going to answer the question, what is sin? 1 John 3:4. What is sin? The Bible says, whosoever committeth sin transgresseth also the law. Here's the definition. For sin is the transgression of the law. Any questions you have about the Bible explains itself very clearly.
Amen.
For sin is transgression of the law. Well, what law are we talking? What law are we talking? Exodus 20:3-17. And I have you know that the law is God's character defined for us to follow. You know, it's hard to move and follow something that you can't see, that you don't understand. But when he lays it out clearly, step by step, now you can follow. And to know a man's rules is to know his character. Very traditional. Verse 3 in Exodus 20 says, thou shalt have no other gods before me. Second commandment, verse 4, thou shalt not make unto thee any graven images. Number 3, thou shalt not take the name of the Lord thy God in vain. Number 4, remember the Sabbath day to keep it holy. Number 5, honor thy father and thy mother. Number 6, thou shalt not kill. Thou shalt not commit adultery. Thou shalt not steal. Thou shalt not bear false witness against thy neighbor. And the last one says, thou shalt not covet. Now, I grew up in church school. I was taught things that all these Ten Commandments were drilled in us as children. And most of us have grown up in the church are familiar with this. So I think a little bit different than most kids, right? I think outside of the box, just a bit. And sometimes the answer doesn't come right away. But James 2:10 says, for whosoever keepeth the whole law and yet offended in one point, he is guilty of all. So I think about that. To forgive me for my overactive imagination, but I try to apply what the Bible says. So, and I say, well, how does I offend in one, how is it that if I offend in one point, that I'm guilty of all of them? So I'll take one for example. Let's say I commit adultery. If I decide to commit adultery and go outside of the marriage, haven't I just made something else my God? Haven't I making another image? It's not the image of God I just created. I just created someone else's image. The image of God says male and female, he made one. Now I done went outside. That's someone else's image. Thou shalt not take the name of the Lord thy God in vain. I claim to be a Christian. Didn't I just violate 3 of the 4? Work with me.
Amen.
Remember the Sabbath day to keep it holy. The Sabbath is a token or a sign between me and God. I just broken that sign, that commitment. How embarrassed are your parents when they find out what you've done? How is that honoring to your father and mother?
All right.
Thou shalt not kill. Not only did you kill the marriage, what if you got children? You've just stolen something that didn't belong to you. And then thou shalt not bear false witness. You just lied. Because you pretended like you didn't do it at all.
Mercy, Lord.
See, I told my kids that not telling the truth is just the same as telling a full lie.
That's right. That's right.
So you just bear false witness, and obviously it started with coveting. Mm-hmm. You wanted something that wasn't yours. So can you see now how we can break all of the commandments by violating just one? Now I challenge you, not right now, but when you go home, think about the things that you have done. And look at how they compare to every one of those 10 commandments. And see if you're not guilty of breaking all. Second thing that we learned about sin, and as you know, in any relationship, there's a progression. So we got the basics out the way. We understand what the law is, and we've been in church for a while. We know how to act. Okay, but let's take it a step further. As our relationship with Christ grows, we get to a deeper understanding. The Bible says in James 4:17, what is sin? James 4:17 says, therefore to him that knoweth to do good, and doeth it not, to him it is sin. Once again, the Bible is very clear. You just spend a little time to find what you're looking for. It's very clear what sin is. If you know to do good, and you don't do it, to you it's sin. And I know, Miss Cookie, you've shared with me many times about the song that says, I keep making the same mistake over and over again. Well, after the first time, it's not a mistake.
That's right.
See, I read this, and just this on my trip this week. And we stopped by KFC to grab something to eat. But on the sign, on the kitchen, said if you make the same mistake, it's a choice now.
That's right.
So their management team says there's no excuse for making the same mistake over again.
That's right.
What about God? If you know to do good, and you don't do it, to you it's a sin. Now, whatever that means, see, I'm not here to preach all the details. Mm-hmm. That's between you and God.
All right.
But we're talking about the progression of the relationship. When we're running this race, at some point you get to the point like my friend, you're shaving the hair. You don't want any sin in your life.
That's right.
Number three. Boy, this is the one. Now, you know, I've read the Bible a few times, and I haven't completed it all the way through, but every time I get in this word, I find something new.
Amen.
In the book of Proverbs, y'all, I want to read this one out loud. Somebody read this one. Proverbs 24, verse 9. See, it's not going to be what I said. It's going to be what you read, right? Proverbs 24, verse 9. Someone read that out loud for me and tell me what that means. See if we're a little confused about this. The thought of foolishness. Just the thought. See, as we're talking about progression, see, there comes a point where you might keep the Sabbath, you might not steal, and you might not murder anyone, you might stay faithful to your spouse, but now we're talking about your thoughts. We get into that nitty gritty, we get into that fine level of competition if you're going to win this race. The thought of foolishness, let's think about the shows that we keep our eyes on. The music that we listen to. Some of the times, and this is not to put anybody on blast, but I can listen to someone on their phone or watching Facebook or an iPad, just wherever I am. And you can just, you hear it. That's foolishness. But we run straight to it. We're addicted to it. We can't take our eyes off of it. The Bible says that the thought of foolishness is sin. Number four. What is sin? Cherished and repeated.
Cherished and
repeated. Is iniquity. Iniquity is cherished and repeated sin. So let's just back up and go for a bit. Let's think about it. We might do the first part well. We might keep the law. We might do right by our spouse. We might not steal. We might not kill. Let's go with that. But how about the thoughts that you have or the mistakes that you make over and over again?
Well, come on.
Cherished and repeated. You know better.
Right.
But you're going down there anyway because, you like it. And you tell yourself, and, you, and again, man, I'm going to be real with you. We done been in church for a while. We know how to say things that make it seem like we're really trying. I mean, the Lord is not through with me yet. He's still working on me. But the reality is, you enjoy it. And you go right back to it. I'm talk to you now. Look, Proverbs 20, verse 11, and I shared this for the children's story a few weeks ago. 20, verse 11, and this is one that, it starts when you're young. It starts when you're young. You develop a mindset and a character. The Bible says that even a child is known by his doings. Whether his word be pure and whether it be right. Again, my imagination, I start thinking. We as children sometimes will try to fool our parents.
Come on now, come with it.
As adults, we try to fool other adults. The longer we go without consequences or being caught, the better job we think we have done. You think about some of the things you did as a kid. I can't speak for you all, but I know some of the things I've done. And I know I thought I was smarter than my parents. As adults, we try to pull things over on other adults. And we think because we're not getting caught, we're doing a good job. But in reality, we're criminals. We are criminals. Criminals think that they are getting away with something just because the consequences are delayed. Or thinking the only reason you got caught is because you made a mistake in your planning. Or in the execution of that plan. You know, I'll give you this example. It was told to me when I first started working the job a few years ago that a criminal will go to prison for thievery, burglary, something simple, right? You done something stupid, you went to Walmart and stole some underwear, whatever, right? And you go to prison and thinking that I made a mistake, instead of confessing that mistake and turning around, you try to figure out where you made the mistake so you don't get caught next time. And see, you go to prison, you end up meeting somebody who was a bank robber. And so now your little petty thing has been elevated to armed robbery. Or even murder. Or a con artist. The thought of trying to get away with something is criminal thinking. If you get caught, and this is what I've been told, that is the answer to your parents' prayer. See, your parents can't be everywhere with you at one time. And so what they do, and I don't know if you got parents like this, but we got some good parents, that say, oh Lord, if my child is doing something that I don't know about, help them get caught. Help them not sleep at night until they make it right. So the fact that you get caught is those good old mamas praying for you. And that's an answer to their prayer. Proverbs 28:13 also says that you will not prosper if you cover your sins. So we're talking about cherished and repeated, but we're talking about another level. We want to be covert. We don't want to be seen, or we don't want to be caught. So we try to cover things up. And my mom taught us, if you tell one lie, oh, your mama told you that too? Yeah, you got to tell another one to cover up the first one. And eventually, you don't forget what you said to start with. Right? So you only had to say one lie the first time. You cannot cover up your sins, and we know that whatever's done in the dark, eventually it's going to come to light. Let's turn in Joshua, chapter 7, verse 16. We're going to talk about what it's like to try to cover up. We're talking about covering up the thought of foolishness. We're talking about covering up those repeated and cherished sins. Joshua chapter 7. And we're going to talk about this. I'm gonna tell the backdrop, and then we're going to read verse 16. The backdrop of the story is, before the children of Israel came to Jericho, which is the first city for the land of promise, right? God had promised the land flowing with milk and honey. And before they get to Jericho, the command has gone out that once we conquer this city, leave everything here. Don't take anything with you.
That's what they were told.
And you know how some of us do. Lord have mercy. You all feeling yourself as you done had this victory in the Lord, but somehow you think it was something you did. And you were passing by and noticed, oh man, this looks good. Nobody's gonna know what I have done. So what happens is Achan is such this character that he grabs, I forget how many pieces of silver, and he grabs so many of these clothing and garments and belongings that he was told specifically not to bring with him. So then at the very next battle, when they come to the city of Ai, I don't know how to pronounce it, the word comes back that there's only a few of them, so this time Joshua, we only need to send about 2,000 or 3,000 men, and we should be able to take care of this. You know, we'll handle this lightweight. Because they just come off this last victory, and they just still got the energy. Why? Because they didn't have to do anything. Right? So now they're ready for this next battle, and 36 men lose their lives. They run back to camp with their tail tucked between their legs. And Joshua says, Lord, what about your great name? How do we look to our enemies if they come running and turn their back to them? Your name is on the line. He's talking to the Lord. And the Lord says, look here. Forgive me my paraphrase. Y'all got something in the camp. Y'all got sin in the camp. And I'm telling you now, I'm not standing for it. And we're going to deal with that family that has sinned. So for those of us that don't believe God is for real, you don't believe that little sin that's weighing you down, that if you don't let go of it, that you will lose eternal life. Let's just read what the word said. I don't want to say any further. Look here at verse 16. It says, so Joshua rose early in the morning and brought Israel by their tribes. The tribe of Judah was taken. Now, earlier in the chapter, y'all go back and read, it describes the order of the families. But then here, it confirms the reverse order. It says that he brought the family of Judah, and he took the family of the Zaharites, and he brought the family of the Zaharites man by man. And Zabdi was taken, and he brought his household man by man, and Achan, the son of Carmi, the son of Zabdi, the son of Zerah, of the tribe of Judah, was taken. Here's where it gets real. He says, Joshua said unto Achan, my son, give, I pray thee, glory to the Lord God of Israel, and make confession unto him. And tell me now what thou hast done. Hide it not from me. Yeah. In other words, here's your chance to come clean what you've done.
Yeah.
Pause. I'm out. Why did he have to get this far?
Right.
See, the Lord had already given instruction to him. Said, Joshua, you're going to bring the tribes up by family. By tribe, then by family. Then you're going to the fathers of those families, and you're going to get right down to the single person. Why did he have to go this far? Why didn't he confess the moment that he came up front, or the moment he took it would have been better? Back that. Leave it there. Don't even bring the drama. But since you did, why didn't you confess sooner? Why did he wait until he seen all these people?
Yeah.
And they started getting close. I know he was sweating. It's getting closer and closer and closer. And finally it gets to you. And Joshua was saying straight up, look now, we already narrowed it down to you. At least tell us what you did. Own up to what you have done. Not a mistake. because it was an intentional choice.
Yeah.
How come it had to get this far? And Achan answered Joshua and said, indeed, I have sinned against the Lord God of Israel, and thus have I done. And I saw among the spoils a goodly Babylonian garment, and took hundreds of shekels of silver, and a wedge of gold of 50 shekels weight. And then I coveted them and took them. You see how he violated one commandment? Then he went and stole it. He coveted first, then he went and stole it. And then he took them, and behold, they are hid in the earth in the midst of my tent, and the silver under it. So Joshua sent the messengers, and they ran into the tent, and behold, it was hid in his tent, and the silver under it. And they took them out of the midst of the tent, and brought them unto Joshua and unto all the children of Israel, and laid them out before the Lord. And Joshua and all Israel with him took Achan the son of Zerah, and the silver, and the garment, and the wedge of gold, and his sons, and his daughters, and his oxen, and his asses, and his sheep, and his tent, and all that he had. And they brought them unto the valley of Achor. And Joshua said, why hast thou troubled us? The Lord shall trouble thee this day. And all Israel stoned him with stones, and burned them with fire. And after they stoned them with stones, and they raised over him a great heap of stones unto this day. So the Lord turned from the fierceness of his anger. Wherefore the name of that place was called the Valley of Achor unto this day. Y'all look it up when you get some time. But understand, the Lord's anger was turned once they dealt with the sin in the camp. The lesson here is simply this. Your sins not only affect you. They don't just affect you. See, if it was just you, poop, you done, it's over.
Right.
But the Bible says that things will be passed down from the third and the fourth generation. Because if this is what's in your heart, oh yeah, your children will pick up your seed. There are things to this day I've never told my children. But I see them do it and I say, how in the world? Did they do it the way I did it? I just did what I did. But the way I did it, with the same enthusiasm that I had, it was nothing I taught them.
Come on.
So what God says is, take them off. Wipe them all out. Living waters. Here's our message right here. Don't think your sin won't affect not just your children, but our family. Notice the whole family was burned.
That's right.
He started with the tribe. Then he went to the family. Don't think that your sin is going to go unnoticed. Realize you are part of a family.
Mercy.
1 John 1:9 says, if we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive us of our sins. And then he cleansed us from all unrighteousness. Now that may mean he burned some people. But hey, that's done away with now. But if we confess, he'll forgive us. Last point I have here is grace. Romans 5:20 says, moreover, the law is that the offense might abound, but where sin abound, grace did much more abound. So it don't matter how much sin you have, there's that much more grace than your sin. Oh, you don't believe me. Let's read what the word says in Ephesians 2:9-4, by grace are ye saved. Through faith, and not of yourselves, it is the gift of God. See, you can't. A gift is free. All you do is say, thank you. Not of works that any man should boast. Now, here's the thing. While grace and God may forgive us, some of us get stuck because we don't know how to forgive ourselves.
Yeah. Right.
Ha! But the word got something for you.
Come on.
It says in 1 John 3:20, for if our hearts condemn us, God is greater than our heart. And knoweth all things. So even if you know God is forgiving you, but you struggle with that thing, know that God is greater than your heart.
Thank you, Lord.
Know that we are saved from our sin.
Not in it.
I bring us to the title of the message, Saved But Not Saved. Saved, the root word is saint. Let me grab you a few definitions. Saved is to rescue from danger or possible harm, injury, or loss. To keep safe, intact, unhurt, safeguard, preserve. To keep from being lost. To avoid the spending or consumption or waste of. To keep for reuse. To treat carefully in order to reduce wear, fatigue. To prevent the occurrence, use, or necessity of. And the final, this is the worldly definition, by the way. To deliver from the power and consequences of sin. Now, in my book, that's the first definition. But in Webster's, it's the last definition. But save is the root word. Saved is past tense. What does that mean? When Christ died for you, he saved you from the power of sin. But it doesn't keep you from going back.
That's right.
See, you don't drown by falling into the water. You drown if you stay in the water. Before I became a lifeguard, because eventually I did get the certification and I did the qualification, I had an experience with another classmate, school friend, and at the time she was my girlfriend, and we decided when our school took us to Lake of the Pines. I don't know if any of you are familiar with East Texas. It's a huge lake. It is not a small lake. But because I was such a good swimmer, she was such a good swimmer, we decided we're not going to stay within the bounds that we were given. We want to see what's on the other side. And might I tell you that on the other side, there were picnic grounds, there were barbecue pits, there were all kinds of other fun things that were very enticing. And so, it wasn't the trip over there that got us caught up. It was trying to get back home. And what happens is, because the water was so deep, it had risen past the level of the trees. And it was warm water mixing with cold water. And we didn't know this at the time. But her body was thrown into shock because of the cold changing back and forth so quickly. And she passed out. We're a long way from shore. And immediately everything that you think you know goes out the window. And I said, Lord, save us. Because she just went underwater, and there's nobody around. You know how you decide to get outside the bounds you're supposed to be in.
Yeah.
You know, kind of like the little story we talked about today, and nobody can save you but God. So, as she is unconscious, I pray, Lord, what to do, what to do. And the only thing that came to my mind was a tree that we had just passed. I was able to get her back to the tree. Somehow managed to get her in the tree because it was too far to swim to go get help. So I had to leave her in the tree, go get some help. Now here's how you know you're in trouble. When the help come, they grab the orange cooler, you know, like you use for your sports, and before we even get out there, you got folks turning around doing backstroke, just doing anything they can. The current is strong. And I'm watching my life right in front of me. Just seems like it's being pulled away. Finally, we get the girl on the floating device. And as we're swimming back, my body goes out. Because I had swam there and back more than once. And eventually, I start going under. And when they pull me up and help me get on top of the barrel with the one I'm trying to save, we get to the shore, they carry off in the ambulance, and all I could do was bust into tears. Because I just saw my life flash in front of me. What I come to find out is I can't handle large bodies of water. I'll go swimming. I still love swimming. But these large bodies of water, I don't go near.
Amen.
Even when I went swimming to the beach, took a family to the beach last summer, I told them very clearly, do not go past this point.
All right.
I know personally what's on the other side of that point.
Yes, sir.
They don't know that. But I know that. That's what sin is for us. So when Paul says in 1 Corinthians 9, 24 through 27, he says, I don't fight like I'm fighting the air for no reason. But it says, I keep under my body. And bring it into subjection. Lest that by any means, when I have preached to others, I myself have become a castaway. When you go back into the Greek meaning of I keep under my body, this is what it says. To beat black and blue. To smite and to cause bruises and livid spots. Like a boxer who buffets his body to handle roughly, he disciplines by hardships his own body. To bring it under to subjection means to make it a slave. What does that mean? He talked about it in Romans. The war that takes place with his body, and what he's saying is, I beat myself into subjection. I will not go back into sin. It's a constant battle that we face. But he says, I discipline myself. I beat my body back into shape. You must be a disciplined and determined Christian in order to complete this race. To receive the crown of life. You must be a strong-willed Christian. Not stubborn. Strong-willed. Strong will means having strong and definite beliefs and opinions, not easily influenced. Stubborn means refusing to change. Refusing to change your ideas or stop doing something. The difference between strong-willed and stubborn is obedience. Bible says in James 2:19 that thou believest there is one God, thou doest well. The devils believe also and tremble. What my father calls demonic faith is believing in Jesus, but not following Jesus. Luke 6:46 says, and why call ye me Lord, Lord, and do not the things which I say? As I'm closing, the process of obedience to the Holy Spirit has three stages. The first stage is an opportunity. You're presented with new information, something that you haven't had before, something you haven't heard before, something you haven't seen before, new experience. You're provided an opportunity. The second stage is to accept or decline what's been presented. the final stage, your confirmation comes after you've made the decision. See, without faith, it's impossible to please you. And to think that you're going to get all the information up front is not accurate. But you have enough to make a decision. My first name is Sinner. My last name, Saved. My appeal is very simple. Our heads are bowed, our eyes are closed. There may be someone here who has not yet been presented with the opportunity to accept Christ for the first time. You may have been raised in the church. You may have heard about him. But you haven't felt that he was talking to you yet. Well, now is that opportunity. You know you've been struggling, but you didn't know why. Well, I'm here to tell you now, there's a war going on. The only way victory is certain is by accepting Jesus Christ as your personal Savior. Is there one today that has yet to give their life to Christ for the first time? My second appeal. It's for those of us who are already in the race. But we still have a little shaving to do. To be more efficient in the race. There's some things that we need to let go of that we just haven't been able to turn loose. Some of our thoughts. Of foolishness we need to let go of. So my second appeal is to that one who is already in the race, but is recommitting themselves to Christ. Would you stand? You ready to let go of some things?
Yes, Lord. Amen.
You ready to put some things behind you? Some things you struggle with. Maybe it's forgiving yourself. Lord, we're giving it to you now.
Yes.
We all are named sinners. Thank you, God. We all have the same last name. Sinner, saved by grace. Let us bow our heads. Our Father in heaven, your word has gone forth. This is our response to you, Lord. We are committed to you.
Yes.
We dedicate our lives to you, Holy Lord, and we are committed to total life stewardship, Lord, beating ourselves into subjection. Discipline ourselves so that we too, like Paul, will not be a castaway. Lord, we understand there are things that you want to do here in this congregation. But if we've got covered and unconfessed sin, Lord, that you cannot give us that victory. So, Lord, we confess all. And we confess you as our Savior. We ask now for your forgiveness for those things that we have done. But today, Lord, we move forward with a clean heart and a new spirit renewed within us. Thank you for your Son, Jesus, who makes all of this possible. Through your divine wisdom and plan of salvation. Bless us now, we pray. In Jesus' name. Amen.